Good morning, everyone. Tax day is just a week away. It is April the 18th this year, and many Americans will be getting smaller refunds this year. Michael George talked to an expert who's been handling tax returns for nearly half a century.
Dottie Pfister has been helping people with their taxes since the early 70s. Some of her clients now are the children and grandchildren of previous customers.
It's like old friends coming in, really, because they've seen me for so many of the years. Like, they come in, they're ready to hug me, kiss me. You know, Daddy, we've been waiting to hear from you.
This H&R Block Pro has seen it all, and she's warning her clients to set their expectations lower this year. The IRS reports average refunds are 11% less compared to last year, primarily due to the end of pandemic-era tax credits.
The big change, of course, is the lowering of the child tax credit, and of course there's no more gift like we got last year, which was like a big $1,400 to a lot of people.
Charitable donations also have to be itemized this year. If you're filing at the last minute, Dottie says remember to bring all of your important documents in to your tax professional. The IRS provides free online assistance to people with a gross income of under $73,000 a year. And ask to get your refund through direct deposit.
Mailboxes, unfortunately, are not as safe as they used to be. So, I mean, if somebody asks what I suggest, I always suggest direct deposit.
Dottie handled 600 returns last year, and she's not slowing down.
Any thoughts of ever retiring?
Nope. I'm here for the duration. I kid my clients. I tell them I'm going to put a table at the gates of heaven. Nobody's going to get in unless they've done their taxes.
Here on Earth, it'll be a busy week as she helps people try to beat the April 18th deadline. Michael George, CBS News, New York.
If you've ever wanted to complain to customer service about customer service, you're not alone. More Americans are fed up with long hold times and how hard it is to speak to a real person. Amen. Nancy Chan takes a look at what can be done about it.
By the time that you get to a representative, if you get to a representative, then you're angry.
Have you ever yelled at someone for customer service?
I think I'm guilty of that. Yeah.
74% of Americans report having a problem with a product or service in the past year, according to the latest National Customer Rage Survey. It's more than doubled since 1976. The number one frustration, having to sit through long prompts just to talk to a human being.
People are having difficulty having what I would describe as an authentic interaction.
Scott Bretzman spearheaded the survey. He blames much of the problem on companies and products relying more on automation and technology. And customer patience, he says, is growing thinner.
8% of people said that one of the primary causes for the increase in incivility was related to the stress and strife associated with COVID.
43% of customers reported yelling or raising their voice, and roughly 1 in 10 are interested in seeking revenge on employees.
But the reservation keeps the car here. That's why you have the reservations.
I know why we have reservations.
I don't think you do.
Social media is also providing a megaphone. The number of people posting complaints and shaming companies online has more than doubled since 2020. So what can people do?
I think a customer care experience from both sides, from the employee side and from the customer side, would benefit greatly from a good dose of kindness.
A reminder that courtesy counts, even when you complain. Nancy Chen, CBS News, New York.
All right, some popular candies and snacks are being put under the microscope. Lawmakers in California are concerned about chemicals added to foods that include red dye 3 that could be dangerous for your health. The food additives have been banned in Europe for years. Danya Bacas explains.
Hendrix, do you want strawberries?
Ashley and Jermaine Rawlings are careful about what they feed their two young children. They read food labels closely.
I'm vetoing every product that comes in here just because I'm always curious, like, what's in this product.
If you can't pronounce the name, you probably shouldn't eat it.
California could become the first state in the nation to ban the sale, manufacture, or distribution of foods containing 5 chemicals linked to cancer risk, reproductive harm, and behavioral issues in children.
These are the worst of the worst.
Assemblymember Jesse Gabriel is a sponsor of AB 418, which would prohibit the use of red dye number 3 titanium dioxide used in many candies, potassium bromate used in some breads, bromated vegetable oil, and propyl paraben.
When I learned that 99% of these chemicals are not being independently reviewed by the FDA, that was my aha moment.
Dana Hunnes is a senior clinical dietitian at UCLA and says the number of additives in our food supply is concerning.
The more we consume of a certain product, the more likely it is that we're going to have some of these negative effects in our body.
Thousands of chemicals are added to processed foods to provide freshness, taste, and color. Red dye number 3 has already been banned in cosmetics in the U.S.
The food industry is pushing back. Nearly a dozen associations responded, saying the federal government has a comprehensive food safety process and the 5 chemicals have been thoroughly reviewed and continue to be deemed safe.
Did you eat the first one?
For the Rawlings family,
it's crazy that I have to look at every single product to even see what's going into my child's body, what's going into my body.
They hope products with less additives adds up to better health. Danya Backus, CBS News, Los Angeles.
And California lawmakers hope the legislation will spark changes nationally. All right, it's that old piece of furniture that's been in the family for generations. A new lease on life for an old chair a little later on mid-morning. All right, we're back. The Masters has come and gone, but those who follow the championship know there are quite a few rules of the course. One of the cornerstones of the Masters experiences is that you can't use your cell phone on the golf course at all. But that doesn't necessarily mean you can't get in touch with someone if you need to. Here's Haley Boland.
It's not unusual to see long lines around the golf course at Augusta National, but a line you probably haven't seen in a while is one for a payphone.
I haven't had to use a payphone since 2004, maybe.
These landlines are offered as a complimentary service for patrons, but many say using one took some getting used to again.
I haven't seen a payphone in so long. It's just so funny. So I immediately called like my grandparents, I called my mom. No one picked up. Left them some cute voicemails.
And for those of you who may not have used a landline in a while, luckily they're pretty simple here at Augusta National. All you have to do is pick up the phone, dial 1, and the number you want to call.
I felt like I was telling the kids, I was like, you got to call somebody when you go up there, because that's the thing. You get called anywhere in the world for free, right? Yeah.
Patrons also tell me they've put effort into remembering phone numbers.
In the age of cell phones, it's not like you just memorize everybody's numbers anymore. It used to be you just knew everybody's number, but now I was just I had to write them down and double check that they were the right ones.
The phones ring if someone calls back. Of course, lots of patrons left voicemails for their loved ones if they didn't recognize the number with caller ID. Regardless, they say it's still worth it to check in.
I just wanted to call my wife and tell her that I was not dead.
The Masters providing the opportunity to hang up and fully focus on the patron experience.
Calling in from Augusta National, Haley Boland, WTOC News.
All right, this week, Buckingham Palace released the official invitation for King Charles's coronation. It's full of color and symbolism. First Lady Jill Biden will represent the United States at the ceremony on May the 6th, but the best seat belongs to a royal relic. Here's Ian Lee.
The ancient throne of British kings and queens has had better days. Conservator Krista Blessley has been tasked with the medieval makeover.
So a lot of my work at the moment is sticking those layers of gilding back down and making sure it's completely sound before the coronation.
The 6.5-foot throne has been a centerpiece for English coronations for centuries after being built in 1309.
It's been used for every coronation of an English monarch with a few exceptions since then.
Restoring the throne is just a small part of the preparations for King Charles' coronation here at Westminster Abbey, now less than a month away. The late Queen Elizabeth II was the last person to use the chair in 1953, but back then, the world watched in black and white. So Krista wants to make sure the throne's colors shine through.
So there's birds, there's figures of saints and kings. It really is an exquisite example of the quality of craftsmanship that doesn't survive anymore.
The historic chair has survived schoolboy graffiti and even a bombing. When finished, the royal restoration will be Krista's crowning achievement.
I'm going to feel relieved when it's over and everything is still where it should be.
So her work for king and country survives for centuries to come. Ian Lee, CBS News, London.
Coming up is the trip of a lifetime. We'll introduce you to the travelers next on Mid Morning. All right, here's proof that you are never too old for adventure. These longtime friends are now back in the U.S. after the trip of a lifetime. CBS's Rami Inicio met them during their journey.
And today is number 80.
They're the grandmas who just kept going. From huskies above the Arctic Circle to hot air balloons along the River Nile, besties Ellie Hamby and Sandy Hazlip adventured around the world in 80 days at the inspirational age of 81 to the Northern Lights, the South Pacific, and the South Pole.
We made it to the Antarctic.
Their goal, all seven continents, 18 countries, eight world wonders.
Hi, Rami.
They found inspiration themselves in the people they met.
It's the goodness of humanity. People are kind. Yes. People are loving. People just want to help yes. and be a friend.
We met in London halfway through their trip.
I think one of the things is realizing our lives are all the same. We all have the same emotions. We just live in a little different environment.
They've both had double knee replacement surgeries.
We're great.
No issues whatsoever.
No! Do you think we got any issues?
Should we all do it together?
Yeah.
They don't travel first class or with anyone who does.
But if you have to have manicures, we don't have time for you.
Let me see your
face. Oh, look at them. They're
fine. What are you talking about?
And they go with the flow, even sleeping in airports. Their trip had been postponed twice because of COVID. Since London, they've swung through Bali, Indonesia, sailed past the Sydney Opera House in Australia, climbed above Kathmandu, Nepal,
Namaste.
And even flew over Mount Everest. Just days after getting home, the two are already getting bored.
81 and still on the run.
A new trip planned for next year, a new slogan revealed now.
82 and traveling we can do.
Ageless adventurers, inspiration for us all to live a kinder, more connected life, no matter how young we are. Rami Inocencio, CBS News, London.
Cheers.
When we come back, a conversation with Neil Diamond. Mid-morning, we'll be right back. All right, we're back. You probably have heard his music. Now singer-songwriter Neil Diamond is at the center of a Broadway show. He talks with Anthony Mason about his life and music.
Wanted to make a musical.
Yeah, I think all songwriters and performers have that.
Not everybody gets a Broadway show.
Not everybody does.
But Neil Diamond has one now. A Beautiful Noise, the story of a singer who sold more than 130 million records.
There we go.
What was it like for you to go to New York and see the opening?
Well, it was kind of like a dream come true because, I mean, literally, it's like, what is happening? Where it began. And it was absolutely wonderful.
With his wife, Katie, by his side, the 82-year-old Diamond, who's rarely performed since he was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, led the crowd in a chorus of Sweet Caroline. At the theater that night, there was a lot of love in the room for you.
There was a lot of love, and I felt it.
Were you ever getting flashbacks in the middle of the show?
I think constantly, from the minute it started.
Yeah.
Like everything was a flashback.
As the show was being developed, Diamond says he told the producers and writers,
I wanted warts and all. I didn't necessarily love it, warts and all, but I wanted it.
Will Swenson plays the young Neil Diamond, whose Olympian ambition undoes two marriages.
They're coming to America.
Mark Jacoby plays the older Diamond, still haunted by self-doubt.
This show is part of my psychotherapy, and it hurt. I didn't like looking at myself in many of the scenes.
What part was hardest for you?
It all was pretty hard. I was a little embarrassed. I was flattered. And I was scared.
What were you scared of?
Being found out is the scariest thing you can hope, because we all have a facade.
Yeah.
And the truth be known to all of them. I'm not some big star. I'm just me.
I'll be what I am, a solitary man.
Just a Jewish kid from Brooklyn who wanted to be a songwriter.
The last time you were here was when?
Sometime BC.
In 2005, Diamond took us back to the bitter end, the Greenwich Village Club, where the singer got his start.
Can I step up on the stage and just see what it feels like to be a 20, 25 again? Yeah.
And she loves me. God knows she loves me. Kentucky woman, she get to know you.
It was my beginning, it was right here.
In the 60s, Neil Diamond climbed the charts.
I am, I cry.
In the 70s, he conquered the world.
I am, said I.
Neil Diamond, go!
By the 80s, he was one of its biggest concert draws. In the 90s, no one sold more tickets than the Jewish Elvis.
It's a beautiful noise.
When we met once more in 2014, he was about to go on the road again.
Obviously, you don't have to do this. It's just interesting that you want to.
I have to.
You do?
Yeah. I don't want to.
So where does the have to come from then?
I have to because if I want to maintain any self I don't know why I have to.
But in January 2018, Diamond revealed he'd been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, a neurological disorder that abruptly ended his touring career.
How hard has it been for you to give it up?
I still haven't given it up yet. It's very hard.
For the first time since that diagnosis, he talked about facing Parkinson's.
In a sense, I was in denial for the first year or two. When the doctor told me what it was, I was just not ready to accept it. I said, oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'll see you, you know, whenever you want to see me, but I have work to do, so I'll see you later.
His acceptance, he admits, is a work in progress.
You're still doing it.
I'm still doing it, and I don't like it.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the hand that God's given me, and I have to make the best of it, and so I am.
Was there a moment in that process where you finally sort of did say to yourself, I accept this?
I think this has just been in the last few weeks.
Really?
But somehow a calm has moved in the hurricane of my life, and things have gotten very quiet. As quiet as this recording studio.
Yeah.
And I like it. I find that I like myself better. I'm easier on people. I'm easier on myself. And the beat goes on, and it will go on long after I'm gone.
Diamond still regularly comes here to his Archangel studio in LA, where the halls are decked with decades worth of awards.
I still can sing.
Do you need to still sing?
Well, I like singing. I've been doing it for 50 years, and I enjoy it.
What happens inside you when you sing?
I feel good.
Yeah.
It's like all the systems of my mind and my body are working as one.
Yeah.
When I'm singing, and it's a great feeling.
given you a pretty amazing life.
I've had a pretty amazing life, it's true. And the thing was that I wasn't always able to look back on it and be comfortable with it, smile a little bit, feel I was worth it. I think all of that good stuff is starting to come into my life.
Why do you think that is?
Well, I can't really fight this thing, so I had to accept it. This Parkinson's disease, and there's no cure. Yeah. There's no getting away from it. You can't just say, okay, enough already, let's get back to life.
Yeah,
it doesn't work like that. But I've come to accept what limitations I have, and still have great days.
Great days, like an opening night.
Thank you so much. I just have to take life as it comes to me, enjoy it, be thankful that I've had it, especially having the life that I've had.
For Neil Diamond, a life worthy of a Broadway musical.
What does it mean to you?
Well, to paraphrase Sally Field, they liked me. They really liked me.
All right, we'll be right back to wrap things up. All right, be sure you stay connected with us. We'd love to hear from you. Enjoy the rest of your day. We'll see you back here tomorrow.